Welcome everyone. Thank you for being here. Welcome to Rio de Janeiro. I'm sorry about the weather. I hope it will improve. So we are here celebrating the 70th anniversary of Wellington. We have several talks today, a round table, a cocktail, so I hope this will be a great first day. And it's a pleasure to introduce Misha Ljubic from Stony Brook. Misha is going to talk about Pac-Man renormalization and scaling of demand abroad set at Siegel Disc. Thank you, Misha.
Thank you, Pablo. Thanks to the organizers, and great pleasure to take part in Wellington's Fest. So it's great to see Wellington in so good shape, full of energy. So exactly the same as I met him 25 years ago here in Rio for the first time. But of course I had so high hopes for the weather, I should say. So that, and I should notice that it is a pattern. So there, 10 years ago, when there was previous Wellington's Fest, the weather was also horrible. So I think that something is going on here. We are being tested, so whether we can survive such tough conditions.
But that was in Salvador.
But the place was correctly, carefully selected. So all right, so I will be talking on one of favorites, Wellington's themes, renormalization. So it appears in many varieties and many variations, and I will present for you some new variation of this theme. So it is one of the topics. So renormalization is one of the topics we have studied. We have been discussing with Wellington for 25 years, good 25 years, and it was extremely interesting, productive. We have collaborated on one paper, and so that is, I think, a quite appropriate topic for this event. All right, so, let me briefly remind you what renormalization is. So just a general idea, and then I will present some new case, how this idea can be realized. Renormalization in dynamics, it is a very simple idea. So you have some phase space, some map F, and you would like to understand this map in small scales, small scale structure of the map. So you take a small part of the phase space and you start to iterate it forward, waiting until it comes back. And you consider just the first return map, and maybe this map has some nice properties, some nice structure similar to the original map. Then you want to do change of variable, do normalization change of variable, rescale this little piece roughly to the original size, and what you obtain in this way is called renormalization of F. Maybe you're lucky and you bring yourself into the same class as you started with, and then you may try to repeat this procedure, so you take another piece of this phase space and go around and around and consider the first return map and rescale, and you obtain the second normalization of your map, etc. So maybe, certainly you have to be lucky enough to make sure that all these normalizations belong roughly to the same class. And so if you're lucky, and maybe you can even repeat this to infinity, then you have some chance to understand your original dynamical system in all scales. Well, at least topologically, so, but if you want to understand it geometrically, and to have some uniform understanding of your dynamical system in geometric way, then you need some a priori bounds on this sequence of renormalization. So a very important notion. A priori bounds. So it is, just let me say that it is uniform control of the renormalization Rn of F. meaning that they belong to some compact part of your space of dynamical systems. So then you have some uniform control of your original system in all scales. And then, you could be even more bold and may want to understand this system really well, so somehow to understand precisely how your original dynamical system looks like in small scales, and you can put forward certain bold conjectures, so which may first come from out of nowhere, and it would say, so sort of, let me call it renormalization conjecture, well, just to the, so just referring to all the statements of this kind, so maybe, so there exists a point F star which is exactly preserved under your renormalization transformation. So some dynamical system which does not change, so in all scales, so looks exactly the same in all scales. And moreover, maybe, so if you consider your renormalization transformation, so as partially defined operator near this fixed point, then maybe this operator also has some nice structure, and this nice structure would mean hyperbolicity. Hyperbolicity of this fixed point. And so it means that there are two transversal submanifolds, so everybody here in this room knows what hyperbolicity is. So you have a stable manifold, and you have transverse unstable manifold, just a hyperbolic fixed point. But also, you want the unstable manifold to have a finite dimension. Dimension of unstable manifold is finite, and actually, in the situations we will consider, it will be equal to 1. So somehow you want this. And so, so that is, of course, just some, you can think that it's just generic assumption of how the fixed point should look like, but this picture actually has absolutely dramatic implications about your dynamical systems. Namely, it shows that if you start with something in the stable manifold and start to iterate your normalization transformation, then exponentially fast it converges. Exponentially fast it converges to your fixed point. And it means that in all in deep scales, our original map F has a universal structure, so it has a universal geometry. The geometry of our map F in deep scales is exactly the same, or up to exponentially small error, is the same as the geometry of this fixed point. And that is what the stable manifold tells us, an unstable direction tells us that there is some universal structure of universal geometry of parameter geometry of bifurcation loci. So the bifurcation loci in some one parameter families, so assuming that the dimension is one, if you take some one parameter family of your dynamical systems, then you will see the bifurcation locus here, which scales down to the limiting point exactly in the same way as on the unstable manifold. So there is some self-similarity, some universal self-similarity in the parameter space. Well, of course, it is maybe too much to ask, so it would be a beautiful picture where it came from. It came from nowhere, actually. In the mid-70s, it was suggested by the work of Feigenbaum, Calier, and Chaltresser, who is here. So it was suggested for some simplest model, one-dimensional model of maps of this kind. So just one-dimensional unimodal maps, they observed numerically that these universal features in the parameter and dynamical, in the dynamical and parameter planes, they observed and they suggested this picture, and the picture was very much motivated by some physical intuition. All right, so that is somehow a desirable picture. So if you have some interesting parameter space, and if you observe some self-similarity in this parameter space, then you immediately should guess that there could be some renormalization procedure which is behind these self-similarity features. Well, so that was this unimodal case was the first example of this kind. Then this example was complexified and brought to quadratic-like world, quadratic-like maps of Dodi and Hubbard. Dodi and Hubbard, and these are complexifications of unimodal maps like that. So now you consider the complex plane C, and you consider two domains, one is strictly inside of the other, and you consider some double covering map, double branch covering map from a smaller domain onto a bigger domain. And such maps are called quadratic-like maps. It is some infinite dimensional enlargement of the space of quadratic maps. And so this setting was suggested by Dodi and Hubbard in order to explain very beautiful self-similarity of the Mandelbrot set. If we consider the Mandelbrot set, which is the bifurcation locus for the quadratic family, z squared plus c, so it is this parameter bifurcation locus for this parameter c, then so if you start to blow up this parameter locus in various places, you observe that there are some little copies of the Mandelbrot sets appear all over the place. So, and these little copies, so my copies are ugly, so, but if you look at the pictures, so then you observe that these little copies look exactly the same as the original Mandelbrot set. So clearly there is some self-similarity, not only qualitative, but quantitative self-similarity. And so the quadratic-like maps explained first at least why these little copies are there topologically. And then, very big development happened. So to justify actually that there is a geometric self-similarity, so in these places of the Mandelbrot set, and it resulted in the renormalization theory for quadratic-like maps, which so brought us in this setting to this picture, exactly to this renormalization picture, and gave an explanation for this kind of self-similarity. So, well, Wellington was in the midst of these developments and played a very constructive and, I would say, rectifying role in this development, because it was sometimes confusing. But, you know, Wellington has this bad habit. When you tell him some nice result, he asks, what is the proof? So it could be very annoying, so it could destroy so very nice picture, so you just want to enjoy. But in the end of the day, you at least we knew so what is wrong and what is right in this field, and the picture came through. It was approved by Wellington, so that it is we have indeed this picture in the setting of quadratic-like maps. Okay, but there are some other places where the Mandelbrot set is self-similar. Namely, so if you consider, so let us consider this main cardioid of the Mandelbrot set. So on this main cardioid, the map z squared plus c has a fixed point, a neutral fixed point, with rotation number theta. So rotation number of the fixed point, and so this cardioid is naturally parametrized by this rotation number. And if you take the rational points with rational rotation number, then there are limbs of the Mandelbrot set attached to this point. So there are these big pieces of the Mandelbrot set attached exactly in this bifurcation rational points. So generally, take any P over Q, and there is some limb attached to this point. And then if you look carefully at the picture, you will observe certain self-similarity of the sizes of these limbs at some points. So let us look, let us try to look at this picture. Cannot. Okay, so it is, I have selected a parameter value, which is golden mean rotation number, somewhere here. And there is a sequence of limbs, so with rotation numbers Pn over Pn plus 2, where Pn are Fibonacci numbers. And here we can see some sequence of these limbs. So, and then you see this picture below that. You can think that it is just exactly the same picture, but it's not. This picture is actually the rescaling of the little part of the previous picture. You see that obviously there is a self-similarity. These pictures are undistinguishable. And according to our philosophy, if we see some self-similarity of the parameter pictures, then there should be some renormalization scheme behind this self-similarity. And that was the goal of our work, so joined with two young guys, Dima Dudko and Nikita Selinger, to design a renormalization scheme which would give an explanation of this self-similarity of the sizes of the limbs of the Mandelbrot set. Or the Mandelbrot set, you can say, self-similarity of the Mandelbrot set near certain parameter values. Okay, and our construction was very much inspired by the old work from the 80s by Bodil Brunner and Adrian Doidi. So they invented a surgery that allowed to compare various limbs of the Mandelbrot set. Namely, more specifically, they just took a very specific situation. They considered this one half limb and one third limb, so L one half and L one third, and they showed that one half limb can be embedded into the one third limb. So there is some embedding of one limb into another limb. This picture above so illustrates the idea of this procedure. It is the inverse operator from the part of the one third limb to the one half limb. Yeah, I did not tell you that the limbs can be identified purely dynamically. You look, so how to decide, how to find out that the point is somewhere in this one third limb? It is some quadratic polynomial. You look at the Julia set of this quadratic polynomial, and you will see a picture like that. That is our Julia set. And here on this Julia set, there are two fixed points. One of them is not interesting fixed point, which is called beta somewhere here. And there is some interesting fixed point alpha here, which is the landing point of several external rays. And in this case, three external rays, if we are somewhere here. And these external rays are cyclically permuted by the dynamics exactly with this rotation number p over q, so one third in this particular example. So we can identify the limbs in this dynamical way just looking at how many rays land at the alpha fixed point and how they are permuted by the dynamics. Here is an example, well, schematic example. So we have the three rays which are cyclically permuted. So what Brunner and Hubbard did, they suggested to remove this sector. So we have here three sectors, one sector, two second, and the third sector, big sector. So let us remove this sector, and let us dynamically identify these two rays. So we obtain a new plane, so some new complex plane, and we would like to have some dynamical system on this new complex plane. So we define the dynamical system as F outside this sector, outside this, so here, everywhere here. So with some exception, we keep the map as F. Here on this sector, we define it as F squared. So because this sector goes to the removed sector, we cannot keep it here. We just pass through the removed sector and go to here. So in this sector, it will be F squared. And there is also some problem with the pre-image of this sector. Pre-image of this sector, this one. And so what Doidi and Brunner did, they modified a map in some smooth way inside of this lateral sector. And they obtained some smooth dynamical system, which is topologically like a quadratic polynomial. And then they did used a measurable Riemann mapping theorem to rectify this dynamical system and to obtain actual quadratic polynomial. But now, instead of three rays landing at the alpha fixed point, this new quadratic polynomial will have two rays. So it is the procedure which brings us from the one third limb or some part of the one third limb to the one half limb. So it's the inverse procedure. And we can do this more generally, actually. So if we are in the two-fifths limb, so there are five rays with rotation number two-fifths, and then we still take a ray, some ray, its image, and we take this sector, we identify this ray with that ray dynamically, and then do the similar procedure. So
defining the map f as f squared in this sector, keeping it as f in this, and doing some surgery in the lateral sector. And we will obtain a map from the 2/5 limb to the 2/3 limb in this situation. And more generally, we would exactly in the same way, we will get some map from L P over Q, from P over Q limb to P over Q minus P limb, at least if this number is less than 1/2. Otherwise, it should be defined symmetrically.
Okay, so that was the Brunner-Dodi surgery, which relates different limbs topologically. At least topologically, it relates, or at least some parts of the limb, so part of one limb to another limb.
And that sort of motivated our definition of a Pac-Man. So here is a Pac-Man. So if you never met this guy, please you say hello to him. So here is this guy. So I had never met him before I started to do this work. And then my young collaborators so introduced me to Pac-Man, so some guy with a big mouse. So, and this mouse is actually dynamically most significant. Most significant. So what is mathematically we are having here? We are seeing, we are seeing here something like quadratic-like map, but with some subtlety. So we have some domain U, which is mapped onto a bigger domain V, in such a way that these two rays, which bound the mouse of our Pac-Man, is mapped to the same ray gamma 1. So it is, there is this empty sector, so mouse of the Pac-Man, and so bounded by rays which are mapped to the same guy. But it is not the only preimage of this guy gamma 1. There is another preimage, gamma 0. And if we remove from the domain gamma 0 and from the range gamma 1, then we will obtain 2-to-1 branch covering. So remember, the quadratic-like map here was defined as just 2-to-1 branch covering from a smaller domain to smaller disk to a bigger disk. And here we have some modification. We have to first to remove certain rays. And it is not an innocent modification. Technically, it leads to a lot of difficulties, but still it gives us certain external structure which could nicely control our dynamical system. That is the definition of the Pac-Man. So the map from domain U, like that with the mouse, to domain V, which is, so after removing appropriate rays, is becoming a 2-to-1 branch covering. Okay, so what is renormalization of the Pac-Man? So it is in the spirit of Brunner and Hubbard surgery from the previous picture. Assume that the ray is selected carefully enough, gamma 1 is selected carefully enough, so that gamma 0, its preimage, and its image gamma 2, so don't intersect each other. So they touch only at the fixed point. Yeah, by the way, this alpha is a fixed point for our map. So assume that we have such a nice picture. And then we can do what Brunner and Dodi suggested. We can take ray gamma 1, its image gamma 2, and remove this sector in between and identify these two guys by dynamics, by the map F. And then we, on this sector, we redefine dynamical system as F squared. Here we keep it as F, and there is some bad sector, which is lateral sector pre-image of this removed one, on which the map is not defined, and we just cut off this sector. So you see, Dodi and Brunner, they did some surgery on this sector. They changed, modified the map in a smooth way, and then rectified it. But we don't want to do this, because this operation is not a holomorphic operation. So that is why we just throw away this sector. And we obtain a new Pac-Man, which will be called a Pac-Man renormalization of the original Pac-Man. So let us think of open domains, but it is nice open domains with nice boundaries. So, it is fixed point. Not fixed point is well inside of the domain. Fixed point, I don't remove this race. I keep this race. I remove only this sector, and I remove this open sector. I remove this open sector, identifying the boundaries of it. So keep fixed point. We don't want to lose the fixed point. But actually, your question prompted me to. So the map is well defined. So the map is well defined. We don't need to do anything else with further pre-images anymore. So just as it is. So of course, when you iterate forward, then some orbits escape from this removed sector, through this removed sector, for instance. But they escaped even before. So it is like in quadratic-like case. It is okay. But actually, your question reminded me that something that I keep forgetting saying, that there is the alpha prime, a pre-image of the point alpha. And in principle, we can keep it. But when we go to the geometric control of these guys, then it is very poorly controlled place, because we keep removing some sectors. And so the asymptotics of our map is not well understood. Here we don't well understand. So it is very poorly controlled. So it is better to truncate our Pac-Man to remove a little neighborhood of alpha prime. And that will be actually the space of truncated Pac-Man will be the space where we have our theorem. So, and it is a hyperbolicity theorem. It is a hyperbolicity theorem exactly in the spirit of this picture, as I have described before. So this operation actually leads to some analytic operator. So there is a holomorphic operator in certain Banach ball, so which is associated to this procedure. And so if you take any rotation number with periodic continued fraction expansion, so it is periodic quadratic irrational, then this operator has a periodic point. Yeah, by the way, I did not say in this picture, when I described this picture, that then I set a fixed point. But instead of fixed point, of course, you can consider a periodic point with similar picture. And you even can consider a horseshoe, hyperbolic horseshoe with similar hyperbolic assumptions. So all this still would give us very good control of what is going on. And in this situation, we should talk about periodic points, though I often refer them as fixed points just by taking an appropriate iterate of our normalization operator. And so this fixed point has a nice, interesting dynamical features. Namely, it is a Ziegel Pac-Man. So what does it mean to be a Ziegel Pac-Man? So it is a Ziegel Pac-Man with this rotation number. So we have our Pac-Man, and we have our fixed point alpha, which I don't want to remove. And this fixed point, so the rotation number is a nice periodic rotation, nice quadratic irrational, periodic quadratic irrational. So the map is linearizable near this fixed point. So there is some domain of linearization. And in this case, so the maximal domain of renormalization is some nice disk, which is called Ziegel disk. Ziegel disk, so let us call it Z, compactly contained in the domain of our Pac-Man. So and moreover, it is actually a quasi-disk. So it is Jordan disk and actually quasi-disk. So it is quasi-conformally equivalent to the unit disk, and the critical point is on the boundary of this disk. So there is somewhere here a critical point, C naught, and there is a symmetric disk attached to this critical point, something like that. This would be a symmetric point alpha prime. So the fixed point has this nice linearization domain, Ziegel disk, which has a very well controlled geometry. So it is quasi-disk with the critical point on the boundary of this quasi-disk. Okay, so that is an explanation of Ziegel Pac-Man. It is this picture.
And the map f star, this fixed point f star, is hyperbolic in the sense of this picture. So, so the unstable manifold is one-dimensional, as I suggested before, as I promised before. And it is actually naturally parametrized by the rotation number of this fixed point. So in the fixed, fixed point alpha, the rotation number is this quadratic irrational, but it starts changing. When it starts changing, we go along the unstable manifold. And the stable manifold has also a nice characterization as a hybrid class of maps. So the stable manifold, here it is, it is the last statement. Stable manifold consists actually of Ziegel-Pacman with rotation number theta. Consists of Ziegel-Pacman with rotation number theta. And all the Ziegel-Pacman has this structure. The Ziegel disk of this Pacman is some nice quasi-disks, this compactly embedded into our domain U. And it is, by no means, it is obvious. So if we fix the rotation number, it is obvious then there is a linearization around this point. But by no means it is obvious, then we would have such a global nice Ziegel disk. It is very important part of this statement that in this stable manifold, all Pacman have this structure, and actually all of them are hybrid equivalent to the fixed point. So for each of these Pacmans, so it is a fixed point, F star, and then we have some other Pacman in the stable manifold, something like that. So we have, again, Ziegel disk. It is our F, which belongs to the stable manifold. And then there is a quasi-conformal conjugacy between these two Pacman. So there is a quasi-conformal map H conjugating, whenever it makes sense, our fixed point to the map in the stable manifold. And this map, H, is conformal on the Ziegel disk. On the Ziegel disk, it is conformal. And all pre-images of the Ziegel disk, it is conformal as well. That is the meaning of hybrid equivalent. I could put here quasi-conformally equivalent. But so hybrid is more than quasi-conformally. Hybrid means that also on the interior of the field Julia set, it is conformal. It is conformal. So nice structure of what is going on the interior of the field Julia set. Okay, so that is the hyperbolicity theorem. And let me go back to the promised self-similarity. So I told you that it is supposed to give some to explanation of these self-similarity features of the limbs near this parameter value, near the golden mean rotation number. But still there is some difficulty in deducing this self-similarity from this picture. At the moment, we went only that far as to the centers of these hyperbolic components. If you take this center of this hyperbolic component and take the center of this hyperbolic component, center of the next one, et cetera, these centers, they scale down to the golden mean exactly as they are supposed to, namely in the same rate as the roots, so 1 over qn squared. So this is a consequence about scaling, but so eventually we hope, of course, to go deeper inside of the limbs and obtain corresponding scaling results for other parameters values in the limb. Okay. So what I plan to do in time, what is left, is to give you some brief overview of related renormalization theories, which are in the background of this statement, and if time permits, to give you some quick outline of the of how this theorem can be proved. Well, so there are a couple of renormalization theorems on the background. It is a renormalization theory for circle maps and renormalization theory for Ziegel maps. And you see that Ziegel maps are right here, so we better have some understanding of these kind of maps. Well, circle maps, we are talking about just analytic circle homeomorphisms with one critical point of cubic type. And if we just cut circle at one point and obtain, realize it as an interval, then we are talking about nonlinear interval exchange map. And say critical point, we can put
in the origin. So also these nonlinear interval exchange maps are often called commuting pairs of maps. So, and there is an attached rotation number for this circle map, which is theta. We assume that it is quadratic irrational, periodic quadratic irrational. And then we can define normalization. Also, it came from physics, so this definition, but it is a kind of similar definition exactly in the spirit as I outlined in the beginning. We restrict our map to appropriate smaller interval and consider the first return map, etc. And this is a well-defined procedure which goes to infinity as long as the rotation number is irrational. So every map can be renormalized infinitely many times in this sense with an irrational rotation number. So it's 10 in this class of nonlinear interval exchange maps. And then I outlined for you so some steps, a priori bounds, and various steps of the proof of the hyperbolicity theorem. The point is that this kind of hyperbolicity theorem was fully established in this setting. And important part of the development, so like in the unimodal case, important part of the development was to go to complexify them, to go from this kind of unimodal maps to quadratic-like maps. Here, important part was to complexify our interval exchange maps, and first complexification was suggested, so first structure of the complexification was suggested by Essen de Fourier, so it is such kind of butterfly. So these intervals, two intervals, are complexified to disks, and each of these disks are mapped to a bigger disk with some slits. I'm not giving you precise definition, just a flavor, so because one can easily spend a graduate class just going through all the definitions and results here. So there is an appropriate butterfly complexification by in the thesis of Edson. And there is another kind of complexification structure which was suggested by Yampolsky. It is called cylinder renormalization. So you take some favorite periodic point, you take some ray here, take its image, and identify dynamically this point with the image. You obtain a cylinder, and you consider the first return map to this domain, and this would produce for you some kind of renormalization in the space of maps. And there is a very, very nice interplay between these two types of renormalizations, and so eventually they led to the full renormalization picture as described here, and you see that Wellington was also in the center of these events. So that is a kind of prototype for what we want to accomplish. But what is important for us at this moment is that this theory is related very closely to the Ziegler normalization theory. And the relation is done through Dodi-Ries surgery. Dodi-Ries surgery allows to relate critical circle maps to Ziegler maps. Namely, what they suggested is to take a Bljashki product, just rational function like that, Bljashki product of degree 3, and it preserves the unit circle, and actually, being restricted to the unit circle, we obtain a critical circle map as defined above. So we obtain a homeomorphism of the circle with one critical point of cubic type. And then they suggested to forget the whole dynamics inside of this disk and replace it by some kind of topological rotation to obtain certain kind of quasi-regular map, non-smooth, and then rectify it, and miraculously, we obtain a Ziegler quadratic polynomial. There is a surgery which can take the Bljashki product and turn it to a Ziegler quadratic polynomial like that. And it gives an extremely strong topological understanding and geometric understanding of Ziegler quadratic polynomials, which was completely out of reach before. And in particular, so for instance, shortly afterwards, Carsten Peterson proved that the Julia set of the Ziegler quadratic polynomial is very well controlled. It is locally connected Julia set of zero area. So just using this surgery construction. So in more generally, if we don't start with a global map, if we just consider a Ziegler map like that, then it leads not to analytic critical circle maps, but to quasi-critical circle maps with which lose analyticity at the critical point. It is some theory that we developed recently with Artur Avila, and it leads to similar control for general, more general Ziegler maps. Okay, so now what is the status? So we have
the very well developed theory of the critical normalization of the critical circle maps, and we have some relation, surgery relation between the critical circle maps and Ziegler maps. However, this relation is not an analytic relation, and so not everything goes so fast, but there are some pieces of the theory which followed from this discussion, with some work, of course. So
if we have a Ziegler map, then we can define now two types of renormalization of the Ziegler maps, similar to the butterfly renormalization of the circle maps. We can define a butterfly renormalization of Ziegler maps, and similar to cylinder renormalization of circle maps, we can define a cylinder normalization of Ziegler maps. And Kurt McMullen proved that if you take the quadratic polynomial, Ziegler quadratic polynomial with rotation number theta, and start to renormalize it in the butterfly sense, then it will converge to a certain fixed point. So there will be a butterfly fixed point, which is the limit of the renormalization, butterfly renormalizations of the quadratic polynomial. And then Misha Impolsky followed up and discussed the structure of the cylinder renormalization at this fixed point. And here is the results he obtained in general, that there is an unstable manifold of dimension at least one, and there is a stable manifold of finite codimension at this fixed point. However, you see that it is not still hyperbolicity picture. So this stable and unstable manifolds, no, it does not say that stable and unstable manifolds are transverse, and it does not say that the unstable manifold has desirable dimension one. So these results were actually proved under some combinatorial assumption. So Gaidashev and Yampolsky did it for the golden mean rotation number using computer assistance, so obtain the full hyperbolicity picture for Ziegler normalization. And actually, there is another development with a very different spirit, very different point of view, some perturbative dimension starting from parabolic point by Ina and Shishikura, who developed complete normalization picture for rotation numbers of periodic but high type, when all entries of continued fraction expansion are sufficiently high. And this theory was very important for the examples to produce examples of Julia sets of positive area. So it is an important development. Okay, so that was the status of events before Pacman normalization. And you see that, so rigorously from a mathematical point of view, the golden mean is covered, high type is covered, but of course there are bounded types in between, so which are not covered by this theory. And in particular, our Pacman renormalization theorem, which I formulated, or I missed it, this Pacman renormalization theorem, it covers all periodic combinatorial times. Here we don't have restrictions. So it gives hyperbolicity for the Ziegler renormalization for all periodic rotation numbers. All right. Now, so I have like 5 minutes to give you a rough idea of what is going on into the proof of this result. So the first step is to construct a certain pre-Pacman. Well, we want to promote, so we have a Ziegler fixed point. We have a Ziegler fixed point constructed by McMullen, but we want this fixed point, so it is a map which is defined in some small neighborhood of the Ziegler disk. It does not have nice external structure. We want to promote this map to a nice Pacman with this external structure. It can be done in the following way. So we take this fixed point, it is a Ziegler disk for the normalization fixed point F star, and we use external rays and equipotentials near the Ziegler disk, appropriately defined external rays and equipotentials, to construct a certain pre-Pacman. certain domain
which plays a role of extension of the butterfly renormalization with pre-Pacman properties, so nice external extension of the butterfly renormalization,
so that if we glue this boundary to that boundary, this ray to that ray by dynamics, then we will obtain a Pacman, and this would be a Pacman fixed point. This would be a Pacman extension of the Ziegel fixed point. So that is the first step, just to do this promotion of the renormalization of the Ziegel renormalization fixed point to the Pacman world. Then we would like to identify the stable manifold in certain geometric terms. So, and there are various ways. Maybe what I would like before going further. So once we have this pre-Pacman, we also have a nice triangulation around our Ziegel disk. So, well, we can start to spread this Pacman around and obtain finitely many triangles that cover a certain neighborhood of our Ziegel disk and which are permuted in the same way, combinatorially, very similar to what the circle map is doing to the renormalization intervals. But this structure is robust structure. So we started with the Ziegel map. We constructed this triangulation. But now if we move away from the Ziegel map to some perturbation, then this structure, triangulation structure, will be preserved. So we can control the structure and the map will act on these triangles in a similar way. So we have some notion of a virtual Ziegel disk for perturbed maps. Virtual Ziegel disk, and then we can start taking pre-images of this virtual Ziegel disk, and we can control these chains of bubbles. Bubbles are pre-images of this virtual Ziegel disk. We can control these chains of bubbles pretty well. So this gives us pretty good control of the structure, not only for the Ziegel Julia set, but the perturbed Julia set. Now, stable manifold. So let me just mention that this stable manifold can be identified in many ways. So WS of our normalization fixed point is equal to the hybrid class of F star. So the set of all Ziegel Pacman, which are hybrid equivalent to F star, and it is equal to the set of F such that the rotation number of the alpha fixed point is equal to theta, so which is a very important, maybe crucial property here, which comes actually in the very end. So I'm formulating it now because I don't have time to go logically through the argument, but this property comes in the very end of the argument. It tells us that if we know that our Pacman is linearizable locally near this fixed point, then the corresponding Ziegel disk is a nice quasi-disk compactly embedded into the domain of the Pacman. And also, it is the same as a set of points F, such that under renormalization, they stay close to the fixed point eventually. N greater than N naught. So the stable manifold by definition should consist of points just which converge exponentially fast to F star, but we claim that it is the same as just being eventually near the point F star. And this statement is something which exactly relies on this robust geometric control of perturbations of our Ziegel disk, this triangulated structure near the Ziegel disk. So it is about stable manifold, characterization of the stable manifold, and every step here is kind of non-trivial step, so somehow one needs to have this very, very good geometric control, and the mouse of the Pacman is exactly that causes all the problems. The mouse, because this mouse
goes further forward and starts to move around and can spoil our dynamical picture. So we don't want this to happen. Well, then unstable manifold has dimension at least one. It is a simple statement because the normalization acts on the rotation number theta as an expanding map. And so there should be at least one expanding direction at our fixed point. And then very important step, step five, so which tells that if we are, so if we are on the unstable manifold, so at the moment we don't know what is the dimension of the unstable manifold. Though we do know that it is finite, but we want it to be one. We don't know, maybe it is 100. But if we are in the unstable manifold, we can anti-renormalize map infinitely many times, and these anti-renormalizations allow us to construct a nice maximal analytic extension of our pre-Pacman. After some change of variable, it's also, if I start to precisely state it, I will take another 15 minutes. But so on the unstable manifold, just by mere fact that on the unstable manifold we can infinitely many times anti-renormalize, then we can control a global analytic structure of our pre-Pacman. And when we control the global analytic structure of the pre-Pacman, we can control the behavior of the critical point. And we capture the behavior of the critical point and show that the critical point does not actually escape, does not escape through the mouth of the Pacman when we are on the stable manifold and many other things. So now I run out of time, but it is indication of certain technical statements which are needed to in order to complete the argument. So, and let me stop here. So many happy returns with even more challenging weather. Thank you.